Good morning and welcome to this regularly scheduled meeting of the Minneapolis City Council. My name is Barbara Johnson. I'm president of the Minneapolis City Council. I'm joined this morning by my colleague, Councilmember Reich, who represents the First Ward in Northeast Minneapolis. So frequently before our council meetings, we have an opportunity to recognize special efforts that are going on in our community, recognize special people. And this morning, Councilmember Reich has a resolution that he's going to be bringing forward to the City Council during our regular meeting. So I'll turn this over to him.
Thank you. Now I'd like to invite the people who are very active in putting this forward before us today to come forward, please, and join us. And this is very consistent with some recent actions we've taken. We've been called upon as a city to react to some concerns and conversations that are out there in terms of how federal policy would affect the things that we have prioritized in the city, being a safe city, an inclusive city, and a city that knows how to take care of its own business on its own terms. And we certainly don't want to have certain efforts to federalize things that affect our communities, particularly communities that might feel vulnerable. And one of the things that have come to my attention is that this notion of a potential federalized national registry, where people be registered based on their ethnicity, based on any kind of orientation you can imagine. And that just seems to me quite reprehensible on the base, but even bad policy, just bad policy. And of course, citizens now want to take action. They want to make statements and they want their city to join them in those. And so I would like to invite you folks to make some statements to how this came about, the communities that you've engaged, and why you think this is important.
Thank you so much, Councilman Reich. And I just want to say, on behalf of my wife and I, just how grateful we are for you. You were so responsive to us when we reached out to you initially. I think within half a day, you had already gotten back to me when I reached out to you about this initiative and invited you out for coffee. So I'm really grateful to have you as a representative. And in general, I feel grateful to live in Minneapolis, where I know that the people represented in me are so in line with our values as a family. So thank you so much. And my wife, Corinne, actually had some prepared statements she's going to share on our behalf.
Thank you so much. Mark took the initiative to contact Councilman Reich, and just so grateful for being able to do this. And for me, a lot of this was rooted back in the work that I am able to do at Fairview UMCC, where I'm a student chaplain. I'm honored to work and learn from many colleagues who immigrated to the U.S. within the last 10 to 20 years, primarily from Syria, Ethiopia, and other East African countries. I've had a very tiny glimpse into the struggles of their lives. A colleague from Ethiopia recently wrote the following about a path of many of his sisters and brothers. He writes, "My employees in Fairview come from Ethiopia, Eritrea, and Somalia. From all these countries, people flee in order to save their lives from their brutal governments. If they are lucky and reach the promised land without being killed, then once they are settled in their adopted country, they will help financially their elder parents and siblings who remain back home. Most of us are not aware of how depressed they are from being constantly bombarded by frightening breaking news they hear each day from their native lands. They spend much of their time glued to their smartphones, looking for any fresh news from their homeland. Much of it, unfortunately, is bad news." This quote from my colleague reminds me of something I think all of us who are lucky to have lived here for many, many generations need to remember. The majority of our newly immigrated countrymen and women did not come to the United States because they wanted to. They came here out of necessity, out of fear, and out of loss. Whether they remain here and become citizens or eventually are able to return home, at this time it is our responsibility to ensure that they are well cared for and that we do not add to the increase of fear, pain, and humiliation with unconstitutional measures like surveillance or a national registry. This is an important time in our country as a nation to remember the freedoms we value so highly and that we uphold these freedoms for our sisters and brothers who call the United States their adopted country. I am proud to be a resident of Minneapolis where these beliefs are upheld, and I hope to continue to ensure the care and safety of those who have come here during times of unrest in their own countries. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today and for your support in this resolution.
Thank you. Words that are very well received. Thank you for those. And I'm going to read the resolution. And this action is consistent with recent resolutions, and I think it sort of pins down some very specific items. And this is a resolution of the mayor and the city council affirming the city of Minneapolis' commitment to protecting all citizens from attempts to create a national registry or surveillance based on ethnicity, national origin, or religious affiliation. And whereas the city of Minneapolis is strengthened and enriched by diversity of our residents, and whereas we intend that our city be a welcoming, safe place for people of all ethnicities, national origins, immigration status, gender and sexual identities, religious or non-religious affiliations, ages, economic status, and abilities, and whereas the city of Minneapolis seeks to secure for all citizens equal protection under the law, and whereas the city of Minneapolis is committed to protecting and maintaining a safe, secure environment that enhances the quality of life for everyone in our community, and whereas the mayor and the city council and the city of Minneapolis adopted a resolution, quote, standing with all members of our One Minneapolis on November 18th of this year, that it in pertinent part committed to pursuing policy agenda affirms civil and human rights and ensures that those targeted on the basis of race, religion, immigration status can turn to government without fear or recrimination. And whereas the city of Minneapolis has clearly codified an ordinance that the city works cooperatively with the United States Department of Homeland Security, as it does with all state and federal agencies, but the city does not operate its programs for the purposes of enforcing federal immigration laws. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the city and the mayor of Minneapolis affirm their commitment to the equal protection of all members of our community from attempts to create a national registry or surveillance program based on the items that we've listed. Thank you for putting this forward.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to call this regularly scheduled meeting of Minneapolis City Council to order. Clerk, call the roll.
Councilmember Palmisano.
Aye. Present.
Gordon.
Here.
Connell.
Here.
Reich.
Here.
Bender.
Here.
Glidden.
Here.
Yang.
Here.
Johnson.
Here.
Quincy.
Here.
Orsami.
Present.
Goodman.
Present.
Fry.
Here.
President Johnson.
Here.
There are 13 members present.
We have all members present this morning. Next item on our agenda is adoption of the agenda. Any changes or amendments to the agenda? Seeing none, a motion to adopt the agenda would be in order.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in approval say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, that carries. Next, we have acceptance of the minutes of the regular meeting of November 18th, 2016, and the adjourned session held November 30th, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in approval say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That carries. The referral of petitions, communications, and reports to proper committees is next.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in approval say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That carries. The reports of the standing committees are next, and the first to report is the Community Development and Regulatory Services Committee, and that committee is chaired by Councilmember Goodman.
Thank you, Madam President. The Community Development and Regulatory Services Committee is bringing forward 23 items for approval this morning. They include a large number of land sales, as well as some license reinstatements and license revocations, accepting some grants, and a number of notable items, including the confirmation of the designation of Greg Russ as Executive Director of the Minneapolis Public Housing Authority, as well as the regulation of intentional communities ordinance. With that, I'll move all items 1 through 23 for approval. I'd like to speak to item 1.
Councilmember Goodman has moved the 23 items on the Community Development Regulatory Services Report. Any discussion on any of those items? Councilmember Goodman on item 1.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Madam Chair. I just wanted to note that we have the ability as the City Council, and in fact, the requirement to confirm the choice of the Public Housing Authority Board of Directors in their choice to pick Greg Russ as the Public Housing Authority Director. They did ask me as the Chair of Community Development to sit on their search committee, and I spent a number of months reviewing applications as well as serving on their committee and interviewing everybody involved. I do want to say that I believe Mr. Russ is an exceptional candidate, and we should confirm the appointment of the Public Housing Authority. There have been a number of questions with regard to how committed Mr. Russ is to working with community residents and neighbors, and I will say that that was one of the questions we asked in the interview process. What is your relationship with residents and the Public Housing Authority you represent now? And we checked references on that and talked to a lot of residents, as did the search firm. And one of the things we found out that was that he was highly regarded by residents that lived in public housing. And he had gone out of his way to work with residents. In many ways, his whole career has been about a true believer in the importance of people and people who live in public housing. And I think that Glendale residents and other residents of public housing will find that he will be more communicative and more engaged and more engaging than any other public housing person, really, in the region. Mr. Russ has told us that if confirmed, he will then start his job sometime at the end of January, beginning of February, and his first order of business is to start making connections with people who live in public housing. And so I think you'll see a different communications plan. I'll note that the Public Housing Authority has hired a communications director, and that position, too, I think will be more focused than it ever has been before on working with residents. And so I am happy to move forward the confirmation of Greg Russ, because I feel confident that while there isn't a lot of trust, I would say, amongst many residents with the current administration, and perhaps rightfully so, this appointment is going to ensure that that changes.
Thank you. Councilmember Frey.
Thank you, Madam President. I'd like to remove item number 17 from this this vote. So perhaps we can do all the rest and then vote on item number 17. And then address item number 17, which is intentional community separately.
No, it's actually item 23.
It's 23.
I apologize. Item number 23.
23?
Yes.
Okay. Councilmember Frey has pulled item 23. Councilmember Gordon?
I also wanted to speak on number one.
Number one?
Yeah. Partly
okay.
I wanted to speak because I have enormous respect for constituents in the second ward who've raised concerns about this appointment. I feel that we do need a change in leadership at the MPHA, and I also was a little bit surprised that we would learn that we would confirm the designee. I think since I've been on the council, there hasn't been any change in leadership at the MPHA, and I think that actually the city was surprised when we reviewed the rules and realized that it would be come back to touch us. That caused me to give a little more attention and be a little more careful about it. I actually had the opportunity to meet with Gregory Russ and talk to him. I actually talked to him about Glendale and let him know that we need to work closely with all the residents there. I think that we're better off moving forward now with the appointment that the search committee has brought forward, with the MPH board has approved. I think that Mr. Russ has a lot of experience and expertise in the area, which could also be advantageous to us. And I also think now we've set the refresh button saying that the city is deeply involved and interested in this and can play a leadership role. I think that the council, when we weighed in to stop the earlier plan that the previous director put forward for how to redevelop Glendale, it sent a clear message to the board and also to the new leadership. It's unfortunate that more steps weren't taken to engage the community and involve them. I do know that I think it was beginning of November, so we've had at least a month to know that Mr. Russ was the person that would be coming forward. And I plan on making sure that he gets to Glendale, that he gets a tour, that he meets with the residents, and is very involved and engaged in that. And I'm deeply committed to ensuring that those properties aren't demolished and it's not privatized and we prevent any gentrification from occurring. And I want to be clear on the record of that. And so I'm moving forward with some reservations, but also with some hope that we can actually use this to get a better lasting and more permanent resolution for all those residents there who I think have been left hanging for too long.
Councilmember Kano?
Thank you, Madam President. I wanted to echo Councilmember Gordon's concerns and thoughts, and I wanted to show my support for the conversations that have been brought forward by the Glendale residents. And I had the opportunity to meet with Mr. Horwich, who's here in the audience from MPHA, and I appreciate the outreach and the introduction. I know Glendale residents are here as well. And so looking forward, I want to be able to ensure that we're really protecting and uplifting this project as a truly racial equity project on transit-oriented development. This is really what that area should be able to lift up and champion, and I think we can do it. I think the right partners are coming to the table. The conversations have been forced, whether we like it or not, about the future of this community and how it should be led by the residents and the people who are there living every day. So I will be voting to support this motion and want to continue to be Councilmember Gordon's ally in this work.
Any further discussion? Back to Councilmember Frye then on item number 23.
Madam Chair, would you prefer to vote on the other items first, or should we address this?
We can
item?
Do that. I think there'll be a lot of discussion. All right, let's vote on the Community Development Regulatory Services Report with the exception of item 23. Clerk will call the roll.
Councilmember Palmisano.
Aye.
Gordon.
Aye.
Kano.
Aye.
Reich.
Aye.
Bender.
Aye.
Glidden.
Aye.
Yang.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Quincy.
Aye.
Warsami.
Aye.
Goodman.
Aye.
Frye.
Aye.
President Johnson.
Aye.
There are 13 ayes.
Those items are adopted. Then on item 23, Councilmember Frye.
Thank you, Madam President. And just for clarification, this is item number 23 in the agenda that's out before us, not item number 23 within the packet. They're two separate, they're two different items. So there was probably some misnumbering, and I'm specifically talking, obviously, about the intentional communities ordinance. So I'm not sure if it has been, please pass it out. Yeah. So being passed out right now is an amendment to the intentional communities ordinance to remove items C1 through 5. So as it would be stated, it's for purposes of this section, a family may include a group of two or more unrelated adults living together in a dwelling unit when operating as an intentional community. And then I have removed the factors including whether the members of the household share the entire dwelling unit and function as a single housekeeping unit, whether they have democratic governance and maintenance responsibilities and sharing of household chores, whether we're including a consideration of voter registration, driver's licenses, or other identification purposes, and motor vehicle registration, and whether the group is transient or temporary in nature as an intentional community, and then finally, whether the members of the household share expenses for food, rent, or ownership costs, utilities, and other household expenses. You should be seeing getting this amendment now, and Madam Chair, I would like to speak to it as well.
Okay, Councilmember Frye has moved to amend the Community Development Regulatory Services recommendation with the motion to amend in front of you. Why don't you go ahead and speak to it?
Thank you, Madam President. So, as I mentioned in committee of the whole, I am entirely in favor of increasing the occupancy limits. Increasing the occupancy limits for a building that can handle increased occupancy, which means that it is habitable, it has proper lighting, the square footage of each individual bedroom is adequate. If we make sure that those factors are in place, and we will, then I am fully in favor of increasing the occupancy limits. It's a mechanism to improve affordable housing and to increase affordable housing in our city. I think it specifically helps young people, people of color, renters. I think it improves the affordability of several of these both single family homes as well as duplexes. And it makes a whole lot of sense. What I am adamantly opposed to, and the more I research and read up on this, I am even more opposed to it, is items C1 through 5. And here's why. First, If we are going to be enforcing these items, I think it will be an absolute mess. I think it's wrong. I think it's potentially regressive. And I think they could ultimately be enforced in a biased manner. This is not the kind of thing that I believe that we should be moving forward with as a city. It potentially even violates our sanctuary city status. I mean, we're talking about looking at people's voter registration, their driver's licenses for identification purposes, their motor vehicle registration, their tax documents. We actually have this in the ordinance. So if we are indeed enforcing these pieces, then I am adamantly opposed to it. If we're not enforcing these pieces, and I've heard people say both, I've heard staff say that we will be enforcing it, I've heard authors say that we won't be enforcing it, I'm not really clear exactly where it is. If we aren't going to be enforcing it, then it should be removed. Nothing undermines government more than passing legislation that won't be enforced, and that appears to be what we're doing. And for purposes of enforcement, I just don't think these are items that we should be getting involved with. The regulation of intentional community, I've heard a lot of people say that, well, we want to allow like-minded people to live together. I don't really care if people are like-minded or not like-minded. And I don't think that that's something that we should be looking into. I don't care what their views are. I don't care what their statuses are. This is not something that we as a city should be involved with. And if we're not going to be involved with it, let's stay out of the picture. I probably will have additional comments, but I'll leave it there for now.
Councilmember Bender.
Thank you, Madam President. I'm strongly in support of this motion. I had indicated at Zoning and Planning that I may bring a substitute motion that would, instead of taking this approach to intentional communities, just take the other approach that staff had recommended, which was redefining family to allow for 8 unrelated individuals to live together. And that's an approach that more cities have taken as they, again, it's very rare for cities to have the regulation of occupancy in their zoning codes. Most cities regulate it as a life safety issue. And so we are one of the few that excludes people based on occupancy in our zoning code. I think that people have pointed out that really deserves its own process, and I agree, so I won't be making that motion. But I think at the very least that this council should not support the kind of language that is in this housing code. Councilmember Fry outlined the things, but I just, even reading them out loud makes me feel ridiculous to say that the city of Minneapolis would regulate the democratic governance of a household, its maintenance responsibilities, and other household issues, that we would have the amount of overreach it would take to check on people's voter registration to decide where they get to live. I just, the assumptions that this make are troubling to me. And as I said in Committee of the Whole, I think it assumes that only some kinds of people should be able to live together in our city, and that other kinds of people should not. And I don't think that we should support that as a council. So again, at the very least, I think we should remove this language that goes so very far over the stretch of what I think our city government should be regulating about how people live together.
Councilmember Cano.
Thank you, Madam President. So I will be voting in favor of this item today, and I want to thank Councilmembers Fry and Bender for bringing up this conversation, and I've reached out to both Councilmember Goodman and Councilmember Gordon about my stance on this issue, and mostly, I just wanted to speak to the ID requirements. And so one thing I had shared with Councilmember Fry earlier is, when we're talking about sort of how to connect our regulatory arms to sort of the place-based registration of people or identification of people, I want us to think a little bit more broadly, particularly because the immigrant community, specifically the undocumented immigrant community, won't have access to driver's licenses. Right now, the state of Minnesota bars any undocumented immigrant from having access to a driver's license. That was a change that happened under Governor Pawlenty, and ever since then, the community has mobilized for years to try to change that. And it's one of the agenda items that we actually support on our lobbyist agenda. through the Intergovernmental Relations Department. So when we're talking about IDs, you know, I wanted us to be more flexible and just think about ways that maybe, you know, we could have built in something about like library cards or what gym memberships or, for example, the Mexican consulate issues, matriculas consulares, which are these IDs that the Mexican government gives Mexican nationals and their offices in St. Paul. And many people have opted to get that form of identification because some police departments, like in Worthington, actually accept that as an official form of ID in order to avoid the immigration enforcement conversation, which we know has a lot of our communities you know, in this shroud of fear. So I just wanted to say that I appreciate all the work the authors have led on this. I am very supportive of the initiative overall, and I hope that this small change doesn't affect the overall intent and impact of the policy. I actually think it doesn't. So this is why I'm going to be supporting this motion today. Thank you.
Councilmember Glidden.
Thanks, Madam Chair. So I've actually been kind of wavering back and forth on this. Part of the challenge I feel is that I wish that the motion had been a little bit more specifically tailored to take out the elements that Councilmember Fry thought were most objectionable. And part of the challenge is it's a little bit of the difference between is someone really trying to get around our codes, some of which are there for the safety of residents, and operate something that really isn't about a household trying to figure out how to live together, but it's more like a rooming house or other things like that. Quite honestly, that, you know, I've had experiences with those kinds of things happening in my ward. I know others have as well. Some of the items in here that I thought were more important to showing that intention were items 4 and 5. I could see items 3 and 2 being ones that could be removed and still allow some sort of a factor test to allow. So anyway, I'll just say that I will be supporting this motion, but I don't know if it's going to carry. I'll just say I think Councilmember Fry that. I wish you would have tailored it a little bit more to take out those items that seemed a little bit more difficult to enforce or objectionable.
Councilmember Gordon.
Thank you very much, and I appreciate having this discussion, and it's interesting how the council maybe changes over time and opinions about this. I'm definitely supporting the original motion that was brought forward in large part because those were things that got worked out in a larger community process. But also, I think there's some misleading information about what's required and what isn't required. Partly, these things were these factors that shall be considered were written down so that we would have a definition, so that people who wanted to be functioning as some kind of a family together in a house knew what kind of standards would mean that. This is essentially the definition so that we have some guidance, both for the people that want to form a household like this and live like this so they understand what it means and those that don't. Basically, the idea was if you're going to function as a housekeeping unit, then you should get to do that and you can exceed the maximum occupancy codes. But they were also stipulated in here because people have lots of concerns about how people might use this in a variety of different ways. So they set some standards. I also want to be really clear that there's not requirements. No one is going to be required to provide their driver's license if they don't want to. We are just saying that we're interested if this is somebody's permanent address, and then we give them some options for how they could demonstrate that, or to themselves or to somebody else if they so choose. We will not be looking at any driver's license for those purposes. We will be accepting a registration when people tell us that they meet those standards, and then they make a commitment and they sign off, say, yep, we feel like we meet these basic standards and these considerations. We're an intentional community. Would you please allow us to live as one? And only if and when there's a problem would we have to get in the way? And problems do arise, and we heard scenarios all over the place about what if people do this, what if people do that, they're going to use this for that. People are worried and they're concerned about it. So this is a way that we can provide some cushioning and some safeguards. I think what will happen is we will have people trying this out in a variety of different ways, and we'll find out that, this isn't a big problem. And if there are problems that arise, if we have the ordinance as written before us, then we'll have the tools that we need to address those.
Councilmember Bender.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just wanted to point out that a lot of the things that are also about restricting the use of these is also under D. And so I think that removing C still leaves quite a lot of regulation, including a very specific one, D1, which says a dwelling unit in which the various occupants act as separate roomers may not be deemed to be occupied by an intentional community. So that is very explicit in saying that people who live as boarders cannot be an intentional community. Item D2 talks about one owner cannot have more than one of these. There is a section that talks about who else can own the property that would be an intentional community. So there's quite a lot of restrictions beyond what would be struck out of C that I think are sufficient to ensure that these are not boarding houses, which again were made illegal in Minneapolis in the 90s, and quite a lot more restrictions on who gets to be and own an intentional community. So removing C just talks about what's happening within the walls of the home. Again, in my opinion, very, very significant overreach, as well as some of these, I think, troubling language about identification. So I don't know, item 4 talks about how long you must live in the home. I personally think that's troubling as well, but I think there's some of these that are more egregious than others. But again, a lot of the issues that I think are covered in here are also in D.
Councilmember Gordon.
So one thing that I would suggest and a commitment I would make, especially if we move forward with it as it's written now, so that we can try implementing this, is to ask staff and others to come back in a year so that we can get a full review of this and we can look at it. And certainly at that point, then we can look at, well, how did these factors under C, how did they play or how did they not play into that? Were there instances where somehow some group was prohibited from doing this or not? So I would definitely be open to staff direction that would require that and do a thoughtful review. And that might also give us a time as a council then to come back and look at possible changes and amendments if we gave this a year to move forward. And I would greatly appreciate that and consideration of that for my colleagues here.
Councilmember Goodman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. There has been a lot of community input on this process. Councilmember Gordon conducted 2 or 3 community meetings. I've talked about it in every neighborhood meeting that I go to on a monthly basis. There's been a lot of public feedback, and this was crafted in a way that would allow intentional communities to be defined as such. I've learned a lot about what actual intentional communities are or co-ops. They have a definition, and having us not have a definition in our code is essentially eliminating the occupancy rule. It's pretty simple. If you don't define what an intentional community is, and you're saying it's just for the purposes of intentional communities, a family of 2 or more unrelated adults, then you're eliminating the occupancy rule. It's simple. You have to have a definition. And so I don't think, I understand where Councilmember Cano's coming from with regard to the issue of driver's licenses specifically, and perhaps there would be some change in that area if there was a concern, legitimate or not. None of the things that people have concerns about with regard to immigration at this point are illegitimate because there's no idea of what's going to happen. But in the end, if you don't have a definition, the definition is essentially anything goes as long as it's 2 people or more who are unrelated living together. And calling themselves an intentional community. And the outcome of that is the elimination of the occupancy requirement, which is not what the community process was in order to allow intentional communities. And my fear is, I was out there telling my constituents what this was. And now it sounds like Councilmember Fry wants to tell my constituents, this is what it's going to be, without getting any feedback from anyone at any meeting at any time. I'm not sure that you attended any of these meetings, any neighborhood meetings. I don't know that you brought it up at any of your neighborhood meetings or asked anyone what they thought or felt about eliminating the occupancy requirement. You and others on the council might be there, but the rest of the community is not. And there have been many incidences where people have said, well, we're going to let 7, 8, 9 people live in our house who are unrelated because they have issues or problems, they're friends, or and they don't meet the occupancy requirement, and we don't allow it. This is an elimination of the occupancy requirement. To eliminate the definition is saying we're just opening it up. But that's why Councilmember Frey feels so strongly about it, because he wants to eliminate the occupancy requirement. He said that. Mm-hmm. And while you might be there, the community is not, and we owe it to the community to tell them, this is what we're thinking about doing, what is your public feedback? Because if there was public feedback right now about eliminating the occupancy requirement, this room would be filled with people. So I don't think I know more than everybody else does. I think it's our job to tell our constituents, this is what we're thinking, and get feedback. And we got feedback. Councilmember Gordon got feedback. I've been out in the community working on this, so has he, and we heard we don't want to eliminate the occupancy requirement. This is a backdoor way to do that.
Councilmember Frey.
Thank you, Madam President. So if this is a backdoor way to do it, then I would emphasize that we simply need to be honest in our ordinance. These are supposedly items that are extremely important to the community, and I don't disagree with that. And no, I did not attend all of the community meetings in either Ward 7 or Ward 2. However, these are items that people supposedly think that are important, but we literally have testimony here today that these items won't be enforced. So you can't have it both ways. Either they're important to the community and we're going to enforce these items, or they're not important to the community and we won't be enforcing them. And there's still definitions in here. There's still requirements that go along with being an intentional community, as Councilmember Bender pointed out. Items D1, a dwelling unit in which the various occupants act as separate rooms may not be deemed occupied by an intentional community. Additionally, we were required to submit a formal permitting, going through a formal permitting process, and you're required to have a notarized contract that works out with the staff. There has to be an inspector that comes in at the very beginning to ensure that the conditions are habitable, that the square footage is adequate. We do have pieces in place right now to make sure that this is done properly. My ask is to not have items in here that we're not going to be enforcing. I did, Councilmember Glidden, I appreciate your comments. I did tailor this specifically to the items that I did not like, and I don't like items 1 through 5. We still have protections all through D. I would encourage people to read D. There is still an intentional community boilerplate that people have to go through. But I think we need to be very clear about what is in this ordinance and what is not in this ordinance.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, I will speak. I won't be supporting this today. I will tell you the feedback that I got from my constituents about this whole idea was, are you crazy? We live with a marketplace in challenged communities that people figure out ways to get around the rules. And I have dealt over the years with nuisance properties. We've got a whole committee that meets once a month to deal with nuisance properties. And part of the occasional things that happen are over occupancy. And I think not having rules is a huge mistake. And I realize that the challenge for enforcement for this may be great, but at least it has a process. It requires people to think about what they're doing. I think Councilmember Gordon's idea of putting this in place and then seeing what the outcomes are is a step that I think makes sense. But just to throw the baby out with the bathwater to me is a mistake. The other thing I will say is there are frequently cases when our housing inspectors have to ask for identification of who is living in a house. That's just part of their job. So whether it's a driver's license, some sort of utility bill, whatever, that's a routine question that is asked in trying to deal with some of the problems we have with housing in challenged communities. So I fail to understand why this is a problem. And if you don't have rules, it's the Wild West. And the Wild West ends up being in the most challenged neighborhoods. I'm not even comfortable with the idea that landlords can only have one intentional community. They will. You think they're the people that we deal with all the time aren't smart enough to figure out how to have another LLC or a partner or to figure out how to get around your one rule? Come on, we live through this all the time. So I won't be supporting this today. Any further discussion on the amendment? Seeing none, clerk call the roll, and I think we'll do a roll call because it looks like it's closely divided.
Councilmember Palmisano.
Aye.
Gordon.
No.
Connell.
Aye.
Reich.
No.
Bender.
Aye.
Glidden.
Aye.
Yang.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Quincy.
Nay.
I'm sorry, Councilmember
Nay.
Quincy?
Nay?
No.
Forsami.
No.
Goodman.
No.
Fry.
Aye.
President Johnson.
No.
There are 7 ayes and 6 nays.
That amendment passes. Then on the main motion, any further discussion? Anyone care to speak? Seeing none, clerk call the roll on the main motion on item 23 as amended.
Councilmember Palmisano.
Aye.
Gordon.
Aye.
Connell.
Aye.
Reich.
Aye.
Bender.
Aye.
Glidden.
Aye.
Yang.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Quincy.
Aye.
Warsami.
Aye.
Goodman.
Aye.
Fry.
Aye.
President Johnson.
No.
There are 12 ayes and 1 nay.
That item is adopted. Next, we have the Election and Rules Committee. That committee is chaired by Councilmember Fry.
Thank you, Madam President. We have one item on the agenda, which was to change up our council rules. I move that item.
Councilmember Fry has moved the Election and Rules Committee report. Any discussion on that item? Seeing none, clerk call the roll.
Councilmember Palmisano.
Aye.
Gordon.
Aye.
Connell.
Aye.
Reich.
Aye.
Bender.
Aye.
Glidden.
Aye.
Yang.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Quincy.
Aye.
Warsami.
Aye.
Goodman.
Aye.
Fry.
Aye.
President Johnson.
Aye.
There are 13 ayes.
That report is adopted. Next, we have the Health, Environment, and Community Engagement Committee report. That committee is chaired by Councilmember Gordon.
Thank you, Council President. We are bringing forward 9 items for consideration today. I'll be moving all the items forward. The first is approving council appointments to the Community Environmental Advisory Commission. There's some for council appointments are for 2-year terms beginning January 1st and ending December 31st. Of Dylan Brandon Kesty, Jenna Grove, Thomas Olson, Andrew Murray, Michelle Stockness, John Stenseth, Isaac Russell Hart, and Aaron Niehoff. Also approving mayoral appointments for the same term of Alan Campbell, Lisa Daniels, Daryl Gruber, Mohammed Yaqub, James Nash, Jennifer Cruz, and Ricardo McCurley. Second item is directing the city coordinator staff to report back to the Health, Environment, and Community Engagement Committee in March 2017 on strategies developed by other jurisdictions to make green zone improvements without experiencing gentrification or displacement of low-income people, communities of color, and indigenous people due to increased property values. Third item is approving our 2017 to 2019 American with Disabilities Act Action Plan. Fourth item is directions to our Neighborhood and Community Relations Department related to our diversity survey reports, asking the department to work with the clerk's office and the Neighborhood and Community Engagement Commission and our various advisory boards and commissions who are surveyed as part of the study to develop recommendations for setting aside seats on these boards and commissions for persons under age 25. And the other staff direction related to this is directing staff to work with the Community Engagement Commission to recommend ways to dedicate at least a portion of future One Minneapolis funding to fund organizations that work with and support neighborhood organizations to increase the number of potential organization board members who are renters and people of color. Fifth item is acceptance of gifts from Xcel Energy and CenterPoint Energy that will allow us to do a community engagement energy efficiency pilot project as part of our clean energy partnership. The sixth item is authorizing an agreement with Pace Analytical Services in the amount not to exceed $120,000 to provide environmental lead testing services for the city. Seventh item is accepting a grant for the School-Based Health Alliance of not to exceed $4,200. This is to continue participation in the School Health Service National Quality Initiative Collaborative. The eighth item is authorizing a contract with Volunteers for America, Volunteers of America, in the amount not to exceed $241,500. And this is to provide health worker services in some of our public housing high-rise buildings. And the ninth and final item is authorizing execution of our second community solar subscription agreement with Sun Edison, and also directing staff to report back about a third community solar RFP. This one will focus on availability for Minneapolis residents and also how we can allow low and moderate income customers to also participate. I believe there is at least someone who will make a comment on item number two, but I would move all items forward.
Councilmember Gordon has moved the health, environment, and community engagement report, all items. Did you wish to speak to item two, Councilmember Gordon?
Pardon me?
Did you wish to speak to item two?
No, I know that Councilmember Cano does.
Okay, thank you. Councilmember Cano.
Thank you, Madam President. I just wanted to speak on this issue because it's something that my ward residents really care about, and a concept that we've been working on since I was elected. I first just want to acknowledge all of the hard work that has gone into this project from our city staff, our sustainability department, and the various community members who bring so much expertise to this conversation. Through this work, the City of Minneapolis has been able to develop and publish a Green Zones calculator, which is on the City of Minneapolis website. And I encourage everyone to take a peek at it when they can, so you can see what the work is looking like now. For this particular item, I just want to flag for our colleagues here and for our community members who might be watching or listening, as well as to our city staff, is that there's a variety of data points that have been collected to construct a Green Zones sort of region to try to zero in on what this might look like in our city. And I believe there's been more than 20 data points gathered. And the challenge here is really figuring out which data points we're going to weigh, which to have sort of a weighted average of being able to implement and identify this region in the city, because having so many different data points and having all of them carry the same amount of significance to identify a green zones in our city is going to be a challenge, and it might even be counterproductive to the whole notion of establishing a green zones. So I just want to put that on the table for my colleagues to consider, and I will certainly be working with our staff to try to clarify that a little bit better. I know that some of the members of the work group have already identified as an area that needs to be further discussed and clarified, because at the end of the day, what we don't want to do is pass a watered down version of a green zones policy, which is pretty dynamic, pretty unique in the nation. And I think we really have to do the hard work of ensuring that this has the intended outcome to really support the most diverse, the most low income, and the most polluted areas of our city, which I think some of us already sort of know where those areas will be, but really supporting that designation with the right structured data will be really important. So with that, I just want to thank Councilmember Gordon for chairing the committee that has led this work, and I look forward to continuing to work with my colleagues and the staff and the community on this effort.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, clerk, call the roll on the report.
Councilmember Palmisano.
Aye.
Gordon.
Aye.
Connell.
Aye.
Wright.
Aye.
Bender.
Aye.
Glidden.
Aye.
Yang.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Quincy.
Aye.
Forsami.
Aye.
Goodman.
Aye.
Frye.
Aye.
President Johnson.
Aye.
There are 13 ayes.
That report is adopted. Next, we have the Intergovernmental Relations Report. That committee is chaired by Council Vice President Glidden.
Thanks, Madam Chair. We have four items on the agenda today, two quite significant. The first is a technical amendment ordinance to our playing language charter. I will note for this that to approve would require a vote of all 13 council members. Item number two is adoption of our 2017 legislative agenda. This is the shorter list of agenda items that city staff will be working on at the state capitol. Items three and four are contracts for state legislative services from contract firms, and I will move approval of all four items.
Councilmember Glidden has moved the Intergovernmental Relations Report. Any discussion on any of those items? Seeing none, clerk, call the roll.
Councilmember Palmisano.
Aye.
Gordon.
Aye.
Connell.
Aye.
Wright.
Aye.
Bender.
Aye.
Glidden.
Aye.
Yang.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Quincy.
Aye.
Forsami.
Aye.
Goodman.
Aye.
Frye.
Aye.
President Johnson.
Aye.
There are 13 ayes.
Those items are adopted. Next, we have the Public Safety, Civil Rights, and Emergency Management Report. That committee is chaired by Councilmember Yang.
Thank you, Madam President. Today, we have six items for approval. The first item is a Minneapolis Commission on Civil Rights appointments. Second item is a Police Conduct Oversight Commission appointments. Third item is a Police Conduct Review Panel appointments. The fourth item is a contract with Corner House Interagency Child Abuse Evaluation Training Center for Forensic Evaluation Services. The fifth item is an application to the Department of Public Safety Office of Justice Programs for Sex Trafficking and Training Grant. And the sixth item is a camera equipment acceptance for the third precinct from Ventura Village Neighborhood Organization for cameras, I believe. And with that, I will move all six items for approval.
Councilmember Yang has moved the Public Safety, Civil Rights, and Emergency Management Report. Any discussion on any of those items? Seeing none, clerk, call the roll.
Councilmember Palmisano.
Aye.
Gordon.
Aye.
Connell.
Aye.
Wright.
Aye.
Bender.
Aye.
Glidden.
Aye.
Yang.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Quincy.
Aye.
Forsami.
Aye.
Goodman.
Aye.
Frye.
Aye.
President Johnson.
Aye.
There are 13 ayes.
That report is adopted. Next, we have the Transportation Public Works Report. That committee is chaired by Councilmember Reich.
Thank you, Madam President. The committee forwards 20 items today for consideration. Item one is the Shingle Creek Watershed Management Commission appointments. Those names are listed. Items two, three, four, five, and seven are all actions to move forward with construction project, reconstruction projects of the roads listed. Item five, or six rather, is Samatar Crossing layout approval and easements for that project area. Item eight is the 2017 Minneapolis Open Streets, approving the list of routes for 2017 Minneapolis Open Streets. And we had a really good report in committee about how our partnership is moving forward with those very celebrated activities in our city. The following items are referred reports to the Ways and Means Committee. Item nine is the 2017 Downtown Minneapolis Transportation Management Organization grant agreements. Item 10 is the grant from the Minnesota Historical Society for Conservation of Sculpture Clock on Nicollet Mall. Item 11 is the item 11, 12, and 13 are all adjustments to contracts that are in place for projects that have already been approved. Item 14 is the agreement with Cohen Partners for PV Plaza Historic Landscape Preservation and Architectural Services. Item 15 is agreement with Minnesota Vikings LLC, evaluation of feasibility of a counterflow crossover between 3rd Street South and 4th Street South. item 16 is the 8th Street reconstruction and street lighting projects. And it's a postponement of a levy assessments for 2018, and that's for better correspondence with our partners at the University of Minnesota. The actions that I'll be moving forward that are listed are one and two. Finance has asked to strike three and four, even though there might be some timing issues with the physical project, the financing component can move forward, and that's what they were requesting. So my motion will have one and two and have stricken or delete 16.3 and 16.4 from the agenda to allow for the sale of assessment bonds for the project costs. Item 17 is the Seward Bicycle Boulevard's layout approval, grant acceptance, and cooperative agreement with Hennepin County, approving those actions that are listed. And items 18, 19, and 20 are all accepting low bids for activities, standard activities of the committee. With that, Madam President, I move all items as adjusted with 16.
Councilmember Reich has moved the Transportation Public Works report in its entirety on item 16, striking items 3 and 4. Any discussion on any of those items? Councilmember Bender.
Thank you, Madam President. I'd like to remove item 7 for discussion. That one came forward without recommendation from the committee.
Okay, we'll pull off item 7. Councilmember Cano.
I'm sorry, I want to get in the queue to speak on that item that Councilmember Bender just moved.
Okay. All right, let's do what we did in Community Development Regulatory Services then and move, vote on all items with the exception of item 7. Is that okay with people, Councilmember Bender? You okay?
Yep, I was just kidding.
Okay, all items on the Transportation Public Works report, noting that on item, I've lost my page here. Item 16, we have stricken 3 and 4, and we're leaving item 7 out. We'll vote on that separately. Clerk, call the roll.
Councilmember Palmisano.
Aye.
Gordon.
Aye.
Cano.
Aye.
Reich.
Aye.
Bender.
Aye.
Glidden.
Aye.
Yang.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Quincy.
Aye.
Warsami.
Aye.
Goodman.
No on 15, aye on the remainder.
Frye.
Aye.
President Johnson.
Aye.
There are 13 ayes, except item 15. There are 12 ayes and 1 nay.
Those items are adopted. On item 7, Councilmember Bender.
Thank you, Madam President. We had a long discussion about item 7 at the TPW committee. And so I just wanted to kind of go through maybe a little bit more technical detail than we would normally have at council, but I think it's important that we understand what's in front of us. As the county presented their layout for Glenwood Avenue, council members Gordon and I asked a lot of questions about why the layout didn't include the kind of curb-separated protected bike lane that we find on Washington Avenue that's being constructed now. And essentially, county staff said that they couldn't do that because of the rules that they follow in their engineering standards. The rule that she was referencing is actually the state's aid standards, which are in state law. And because this is classified as an arterial road under the state aid standards, she was saying that a roadway like this, an arterial road, would require an 11-foot travel lane with a 4-foot wide reaction distance on the curb, and that required reaction distance precludes putting a curb that would separate the bikes and pedestrians from cars on this road. So the state aid standards are actually so out of sync even with MnDOT's own highway standards that the legislature passed a law directing them to update their standards by this August, and they're over past that deadline. I understand that those updated state aid standards will be available in a couple of months. That was, again, per the state legislature's action a couple of sessions ago, supposed to be completed by this past August. But my understanding is things like this, which are, again, so outdated that their own trunk highway rules don't include them anymore, will soon be gone from state law, which I think is a good thing for cities. But even with this particular law on the books still, and the county still using these outdated standards, there's a variance process from the state aid standards, and all of the variances that had come forward in 2014 and 15 were approved by MnDOT. So there is a process to design this road in a way that would be more safe for all users. The troubling thing about designing a road with such a big reaction distance and such wide overall width for cars is that speed really matters in terms of the safety of a road for all users. If you design a road for cars to go 40 miles an hour, you're putting people in danger, because if someone is hit at that speed, they have an 80% chance of dying. And even if you reduce the design speed to 30 miles an hour, that's an inverse. You only have a 40% chance of dying if you're hit at 30 miles an hour. And this is a road that is expected to have a lot of pedestrians on it. And so I think that it's very difficult for me to support a road that is coming forward with an unsafe design. This will have a sidewalk, a wider sidewalk. It will have a bike lane that will have some of those white sticks in the warm weather months, but not in the winter time. And again, with a slight change to the road, we could have a much safer facility that we know gets people out of their cars and into bike lanes, that we know would work for all users. There would still be plenty of space for cars to drive. There would be no impact on the number of lanes, simply on the width of those lanes. And so I can't support this design for those reasons. So as I did at committee, I'll be voting against this today.
Councilmember O'Connell.
Thank you, Madam President. So I've been doing a lot of listening from the area residents who have been raising concerns about this particular issue. And I just want to share, you know, a personal story of how I connect to this conversation and why I've been listening to the residents. In 2013, when I was running for office, there was a small boy, 10-year-old boy, who was hit on 26th Street and ended up dying. And as many of you know, 26th and 28th are some of the streets that we have been working very hard to make safer for pedestrians and for people who bike as a mode of transportation. So when people reach out to me with issues like this, I really engage and listen and want to work with them to find a solution. So for me, after hearing that the current design is actually not as safe as it could be, and I think that's the challenge here, is that it can be safer. This is something we can do today. This is something under our control. This is something that we can impact. This is something that we can influence and make a difference in. It just makes me a little sad to know that you know, this would be moving in the wrong direction. So you know, I know that the safer design would not cost more than the current proposal, which is huge. Again, this is something that we can shape, we can make better, and that's not going to pull money from any other direction or negatively influence any other project that might be on the table. So so when that happened in 2013, when that 10-year-old boy died because he was hit in one of these streets where it's very unsafe for people to bike and walk, bringing down car speeds from 40 miles per hour to 30 miles per hour could have made the difference in saving this little boy's life. So I don't take this vote lightly. I think there's a lot on the table. And the fact that this item is coming to us without a recommendation is huge. That means that we should be doing more conversations. That means we should be working harder with the county to find a solution that our community residents, that our voters, that our taxpayers can support. And I think that's the type of leadership that we should be bringing to the table to ensure that we're listening to the area residents, that we're working with them, and that we're crafting the solutions that are going to bring everyone together. So I will be voting no on this item today.
Councilmember Yang.
Thank you, Madam President. I'm speaking today to urge my colleagues to support the staff recommendation for the layout of Glenwood Avenue. For background, Glenwood Avenue is a county road, and this is a county project, and this redesign and rebuild is from the county and is asking for us for municipal consent. It was brought before the Pedestrian and Bicycle Advisory Committees in April and was approved by both. The Bicycle Advisory Committee asked for a complete buffered bike lane and better connections to the Cedar Lake Trail, but approved the layout otherwise. This layout was first supposed to be presented to us at the beginning of November at TPW and then to the council. Both myself and Councilmember Goodman supported the layout as it was presented then. Shortly before it was to be presented to TPW, some members of the Bicycle Advocacy Committee raised concerns about the design of the roadway and their desire for protected bike lanes. Layout approval was pulled from the November 7th agenda, and Hennepin County agreed to a meeting with city staff, including staff from my office, Council Member Goodman's office, along with advocates. And I can tell you, I mean, there were probably about, I want to say, 12 to 15 staffers from both the city and the county there for that meeting. The meeting was held and other options for the layout were discussed. Given a number of technical and operational challenges, Hennepin County did not recommend an off-street protected bike lane. I was okay with this in the first place, and I'm okay with it now. Glenwood Avenue is an important corridor for truck traffic. Both commercial trucks going to and from the farmers market in downtown and commercial trucks leaving the large industrial area to the west of this section travel through here regularly. That needs to be accommodated. This layout fulfills the city policy of complete streets. The buffered bike lane is a good amenity that will allow bikers from the west to approach downtown more safely than they do now. The real gem of this layout, though, is a commitment to the pedestrian realm. Aside from the fact that like bikers, pedestrians are people too, pedestrians are doubly important in this area. First is the proximity to the farmers market and the planned BRT transit. Transit users usually turn into pedestrians when they get off of transit, and as we increase connections to the farmers market, we need to ensure that foot traffic is promoted and safe. Between new plantings and a wider pedestrian realm, this proposal does a good job of that. Second is the number of homeless in this area. This layout is at the intersection of several large homeless shelters in an area of lots of supportive services for our homeless population. Promoting the pedestrian realm in this corridor is promoting a safe space for people who would usually keep on the margins of society. I have to admit, I feel like the county and the city did some extra outreach and engagement on this project, and that seems to not be acknowledged here today. But, you know, I was a bit surprised when my colleagues took an extra interest in this. And, you know, I understand that, you know, bike lanes can be the measure of success in Minneapolis, but success in North Minneapolis might be a little bit different and nuanced. And, you know, I would say, you know, if my colleagues have more time or more free time to devote to North Side issues, I'd like to draw their attention to the regional drug market operating for the west down Glenwood. Figuring out solutions to make sure that residents from the rest of Minneapolis and the region don't come to North Minneapolis to buy heroin would be welcomed by the residents of Ward 5 in my office in the police department. And it would at least be a good use of energy. It would be as good a use of energy as picking a fight with the county about road design in this case. I urge my colleagues to support the layout as provided by the county.
Councilmember Glidden.
Thanks, Madam Chair. At our Transportation and Public Works Committee meeting, I would say that I had done my normal homework in preparing for that meeting, and this was not a topic that had really generated much public commentary. And as Councilmember Yang had noted, both the pedestrian and the bicycle advisory committees had reviewed the project and had actions approving the layout. And I voted at that meeting to support the layout. I'm doing something that I think I've only done a very few times when I've been on the council, but I am going to have a different vote today on this. And I'm not going to support the layout. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail, but there have been some incidents that have happened recently around the city that are making me believe that we need to be even firmer on how we challenge what I think are assumptions about what we can and should do and how safe our streets should be for pedestrians and for bicyclists. I know not everybody agrees with whether we build additional bicycle infrastructure, and sometimes that continues to be a conversation. But to me, I will say the bigger issue ends up being whether we are doing things that impact the rate of speed at which vehicles travel, and thus then how safe our streets are for everyone who needs to use them. So with that, I am not going to support the layout coming forward today.
Councilmember Bender.
Thank you, Madam President. I just wanted to briefly say that both the PAC and the BAC passed updated resolutions at their last meetings. The Bicycle Advisory Committee was specific that they supported protected bike lanes wherever feasible, including a total roadway width that had a two curb reaction distance, which would allow for the protected curb separated kind that's on Washington. And then the Pedestrian Advisory Committee acknowledged that since their resolution that previous April, that We understand the North Minneapolis Bicycle Advisory Council has advocated for protected bike lanes in lieu of the city's proposed on-street bike lanes. The PAC is not opposed to this in concept, but they didn't have a specific design, so they did not take a specific position. But I just wanted to note that both of those advisory bodies did discuss this with more information at their past meetings, not having had the alternative from the county to consider. They didn't vote on a specific layout.
Any further discussion on the Transportation Public Works Report, item 7? Seeing none, sounds like we have a divided vote. So let's have the clerk call the roll.
Councilmember Palmisano.
Aye.
Gordon.
No.
Connell.
Hold on a second. So, no.
Reich.
Aye.
Bender.
No.
Glidden.
No.
Yang.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Quincy.
Aye.
Warsami.
Aye.
Goodman.
Aye.
Frye.
Aye.
President Johnson.
Aye.
There are 9 ayes and 4 nays.
That item is adopted. Next, we have the Ways and Means Committee report. That committee is chaired by Councilmember Quincy.
Thank you, Madam President. Ways and Means brings forward 23 items for your consideration today. The first 5 items are from the City Attorney's Office. They represent various legal settlements. We also have 3 contracts coming from the City Attorney's Office, a selection of bond counsel, as well as from the Clerk's Office. We have 2 items in preparation and in acknowledgement of our sesquicentennial. We also have a grant acceptance from the Funders Network for Smart Growth and Livable Communities, contract with the Improved Group for services related to the Recast Minneapolis grant, an agreement with Public Art Consulting for Weber Park Library. We have a contract amendment with Peterson Companies for a contract closeout at projects related to the Convention Center, as well as the insurance premium for the Convention Center. We have a contract with Perkins and Will for the pre-design and program development services for the new downtown office building project. We have a general fund contingency budget usage resolution as item number 18. Item number 19 are resolutions related to the target market ordinance and the permanent review committee. Item number 20 is the official IRS intent declaration to issue tax-exempt bonds. Item number 21 is the City of Minneapolis accounts receivable policy. We also have a gift acceptance for conference travel, as well as a revenue agreement with the Downtown Improvement District for the 2016 Holidazzle Police Officer Assistance. Happy to move all 23 items for approval.
Councilmember Quincy has moved the Ways and Means Committee report. Any discussion on any of those items? Seeing none, I'm just going to mention on item 13 that it looks like we've spent about $245,000 of the $1 million grant for the recast program already. So I don't know that we've had a full explanation of what we're going to do with that grant, but anyway, we've spent $245,000 on it. So, clerk, call the roll.
Councilmember Palmisano.
Aye.
Gordon.
Aye.
Connell.
Aye.
Reich.
Aye.
Bender.
Aye.
Glidden.
Aye.
Yang.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Quincy.
Aye.
Warsami.
Aye.
Goodman.
Aye.
Frye.
Aye.
President Johnson.
Aye.
There are 13 ayes.
That report is adopted. Next, we have the Zoning and Planning Committee report. That committee is chaired by Councilmember Bender.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We have 3 items from Zoning and Planning. Item number 1 is denying an appeal for a certificate of appropriateness and allowing for the demolition of a building at 2019 East Lake Street. Item number 2 is approving an application for a rezoning at 12 through 18 West 15th Street to allow for a 75-unit residential development. And item number 3 is approving an application for a street vacation of 30th Avenue South for Metro Transit. I will move items 1 through 3. I just wanted to make a brief comment on item number 1.
Councilmember Bender has moved the Zoning and Planning report and wishes to comment on item 1.
Thank you, Madam President. And I believe Councilmember Cano also wants to speak on this item, but I just wanted to briefly say this is the Vermashave building that we had quite a long presentation about at the Zoning and Planning Committee. This is a historic resource designated, but staff found that it was in too bad of condition to block the demolition of the building. And so we had quite a long presentation by the folks who have done a lot of research about the history of this building. It's certainly a very interesting history, but again, it was the condition of the building that led us to deny that appeal.
Councilmember Connell.
Thank you, Madam President. I wanted to speak to this issue because I've had a resident come and meet with me and email me about the Bermesheev building. And this is in the 9th Ward. And the Bermesheev building is a part of the development plans that Minneapolis Public Schools has for moving the adult basic education services from the corner where the Hennepin County will establish their new Southside hub, and then we'll be shifting to the northern side of South High. And so I've been working on this project for 3 years. And I've recently heard from Mr. Steve Sandberg, who is a dear resident of ours, and I just want to acknowledge that he single-handedly did so much research on the historic significance of this building, and he, you know, submitted the paperwork to essentially get the city to look at this issue. He understands the city has reviewed this process, as Councilmember Bender has mentioned, and he understands that the proposal will be moving forward for demolition, but he does want us to make sure that we can play a part in ensuring that Minneapolis Public Schools can hire an organization called Better Futures to do the demolition. And this organization helps to meet our city's goals to be a zero-waste city and provides job training opportunities for people who wouldn't traditionally have access to jobs to essentially repurpose the building materials and deconstruct and demolish, help with the demolition of the building. So I just want to say that I'm working on that, and I understand how important this building might be for some people in my neighborhood, but it, you know, this project has been moving for a long time, and after going through the proper city process, has been found to be you know, something that we can demolish and that we can perhaps you know, make better for the area, as East Lake Street right now is challenged with a lot of issues of crime and safety and development. So I just wanted to say that you know, I thank Mr. Steve Sandberg for bringing this forward to my attention and for working with us on this, and I will be voting for this item today.
Any further discussion on the zoning and planning report? Seeing none, clerk, call the roll.
Councilmember Palmisano.
Aye.
Gordon.
Aye.
Connell.
Aye.
Reich.
Aye.
Bender.
Aye.
Blidden.
Aye.
Yang.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Quincy.
Aye.
Warsami.
Aye.
Goodman.
Aye.
Fry.
Aye.
President Johnson.
Aye.
There are 13 ayes.
That report is adopted. Next, we have the introduction and referral calendar. First is pursuant to notice, I give notice to introduce the subject matter of an ordinance amending the code relating to noise for first reading and referral to Public Safety, Civil Rights, and Emergency Management Committee, amending regulations related to noisy and unruly assemblies. Any discussion on that introduction? Seeing none, all in approval say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That carries. Next, we have pursuant to notice, Councilmember Palmisano introduces the subject matter of an ordinance amending the code relating to administration for first reading and referral to the Committee of the Whole, adding a new chapter 41 relating to information governance. Any discussion on that introduction? Seeing none, all in approval say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That carries. Next, we have the resolution that was presented at the beginning of the meeting, or prior to the meeting, I guess, opposition to a National Registry resolution. Any discussion on that resolution? Seeing none, all in approval say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That carries. Under new business, we have a proposed charter amendment, which is receiving and filing the transmittal letter from the Charter Commission relating to a proposed charter amendment for the use of premiums received in a bond sale. Any discussion on that item? Councilmember Glidden moves to introduce the subject matter of an ordinance amending the code, and we need unanimous consent for that, directing the city clerk to publish notice of the public hearing to be conducted by Committee of the Whole at its regular meeting of January 11th, 2017. Any discussion on that ordinance? Unanimous consent is required. All in approval say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That carries. Councilmember Fry gives notice of intent to introduce at the next regular meeting of the City Council the subject matter of an ordinance amending the code relating to license and business regulations, amending provisions related to organizational eligibility for gambling licensure. That notice is given. Councilmember Goodman and Frey give notice of intent to introduce at the next regular meeting of the City Council the subject matter of an ordinance amending the code relating to streets and sidewalks, Downtown Business Improvement District, amending petitioning requirements to match state statute. That notice is given. On item four, Councilmember Yang.
Thank you, Madam President. For item number four, it's a legal matter with Northern Meadows LLC, and it's I'd like to move this item for approval. It's authorizing the City Attorney's Office to participate in settlement negotiations on two pending matters involving the MPCA and Northern Meadows LLC, and to seek to have the city joined as a party in one or both matters if necessary to protect the city's interests and facilitate settlement terms.
Councilmember Yang has moved item four, legal matter of Northern Meadows LLC. Any discussion on that motion? Seeing none, all in approval say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That carries. Announcements are next. Any announcements? Councilmember Quincy.
Thank you, Madam President. I just had a quick announcement. I know we're about to adjourn for the balance of the year and the holidays, but I wanted to always take this opportunity, as I do each year, to remind my colleagues that there is the March and Silent Vigil, excuse me, for the 32nd Homeless Memorial March and Service. That will be on December 15th on Thursday. That is the it begins at 5 p.m. at the Hennepin County Government Center, and the march proceeds down 5th Street towards Nicollet Avenue down to 28th Street and begins a 6:30 service of remembrance at Simpson United Methodist Church, followed by a community meal at 7:30. So I think I've been to about at least 15 of those. I encourage my colleagues to always keep the homeless or formerly homeless who have died in their hearts and prayers as they proceed through the holiday season and the end of the year. Thank you.
Councilmember Yang.
Thank you, Madam President. I just wanted to briefly give a shout out to the North High Polars football team for winning a state championship this year. And this was the first time in about 38 years that City of Minneapolis public school, high school had won. And so I want to give a shout out to the Polars.
Yay, Polars. Are they going to come down and visit us at some point, Councilmember Yang? We probably couldn't put it together now.
Huh? Yeah, they will. Probably okay. The first or second cycle next
great.
Year.
Great, great. Any further announcements? If not, this is our last council meeting of the year, and I want to thank all of my colleagues for the great work that the City Council did this year. Lots of inventive and helpful things, I think, for our citizens. We had a budget process that was a very respectful budget process, and I think probably one of the most peaceful ones that I've been through. So thanks to all, and thanks to our great staff that works to assist our citizens of our city. And I wish all of our citizens, be they residents or visitors or workers in our city, a very safe and peaceful holiday season. Thank you all very much, and a motion to adjourn is in order. Moved and seconded. All in approval say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That carries. Thank you. We are adjourned.